case of 55 years lady who is a resident of Bihar, a homemaker, and presented to the OPD with the chief complaint of ulcer proliferative lesion in the right arm for past 9 months. So there's a history of an accidental burn to the abdomen, bilateral upper and the lower limbs 20 years back. And I went treatment for that. There were regular dressings done, and the burnt lesions were healed with scar and a contracted deformity, which was involving the neck, bilateral upper limbs, and also bilateral lower limbs, which made the patient incapable of walking. And after 3 months, the patient underwent surgery for the correction of the contracted deformity of the bilateral lower limbs first, after which the patient was able to walk. Then the next surgery was done for the left upper limb, and the contracted deformity was corrected. Then the patient was being taken up for the correction of the deformity in the right arm as well, but the patient was not fit for surgery for the correction of the deformity. However, the right side nephrectomy was done after 4 years of history of getting burnt. She was then apparently well for a period of 10-15 years, and 9 months back she complained of a blister over the right arm, and there was history of itching associated with it, subsequently which she developed an ulcer, and that ulcer was initially around 2 into 2 cm, and it has rapidly progressed over 9 months to the present size of around 8 into 8 cm. It is present in the right arm, involving the elbow also, and the patient is also complaining of bleeding from the lesion. The patient is, there is no history of pain, there is no history of constitutional symptoms, and there is no history suggestive of distant metastasis. There is no history of radiation exposure, and there is no history of trauma. And the patient is not a known diabetic or hypertensive. There is no history of any other chronic medical illness like tuberculosis, and the patient is consumes mixed diet and with normal bowel data habits, normal sleep pattern, and with no history of any addictions or drug abuse. The patient gives no history of malignancy in any first degree relative. Coming to the examination, sir, general physical examination, I examined her in the sitting position in a well-lit room after taking an informed consent. Her performance status is 90 by cutoff keys, and sir, because of the deformity,
can't comment
on the performance. And nutritionally, sir, she's well preserved, and her hydration status is adequate, and there's no pallous sinusitis, ictus, clubbing, or generalized lymphadenopathy. However, there's axillary lymphadenopathy on the right side, which I would like to take separately. Then, sir, on general physical examination, there are also multiple burnt lesions which are involving the head and neck region, bilateral upper limbs, the trunk, the entire abdomen, and bilateral lower limbs. So then examination of the upper limbs. The examination of left upper limb is normal except the scar. The scar.
Can you show the left side,
Rohita? I have the problem.
There are, yes, please describe the left.
So there are. So the burnt. There are heel scars of the
burn. Call them PVC, post burn contractures.
Post burn contractures.
So they are present on the left side. Left otherwise, side. Movements are more or less normal.
Normal, sir.
There is no wasting, and the left upper limb looks normal. That's
yes,
what you're saying?
Yes, okay. Sir. Attitude
the
of
whole limb needs to be described, yes, because there are findings in this.
Yes, sir. So the right upper limb is in the attitude of flexion at the shoulder joint, flexion at the elbow joint.
Flexion, I think. Flexion or reduction?
Sorry, adduction, sorry. I'm sorry, sir. So there is adduction at the shoulder joint, there is flexion at the elbow joint, there is flexion at the wrist joint, and then there is extension at metacarpophalangeal, and the flexion proximal interphalangeal joint with slight extension at the distal interphalangeal joint. And there is visible deformity, contracture deformity, post burns. There is a visible swelling which is around 10 into 7 centimeters.
Now just describe the scar that will take care of it. Come closer and look. This scar has hypopigmented patches.
So there are hypopigmented as well as hyperpigmented patches which are present over the burn scars, over the scars. So there are multiple erosions also present over the scars from which the pus discharge is visible. The scabs are present, pus flakes and scabs, and there is some erythema also present in some part of the scar, and then there is there's a growth which is around 8 into 7 centimeters. It's an ulcer of proliferative growth which is present over the extensor aspect of the arm, just reaching the elbow. It is around 8 into 7 centimeters with irregular margins, eroded edges, slough present on the floor, with slough present on the floor and bleeding from the lesion which is visible. It is so induration cannot be assessed because the surrounding region is indurated on account of the previous scar. So this is the swelling. Sorry, this is the swelling, sir. It's a cystic swelling which is extending around 5 cm from the wrist joint till the growth, till 2 cm above the elbow joint. The growth is cystic, it is slightly tender.
That's not growth.
Sorry, swelling. The swelling is cystic and slightly tender.
What you've described, now come to the point.
So it's an 8 into 7 centimeter ulcer of proliferative growth involving the extensor aspect of the arm, which is just reaching the from the elbow joint, olecranon process, and extending around 7 centimeter above into over the arm. And it has irregular margins, eroded edges, with slough present on the floor and the base formed by the underlying soft tissue and the bone, humerus. And there is visible bleeding from the lesion, and it is fixed. Immobile, sir, it is fixed, and the induration cannot be commented upon accurately because of the scar. And then there is hypesthesia, and there's an area of anesthesia present over the C6 dermatome. Otherwise, in the remaining dermatomes, there is no sensory deficit, and because of the contracture deformity, the motor examination could not be done properly. The radial distal pulsations are felt normally, and there is axillary lymphadenopathy. Around 1 into 1 and another 1.5 into 1 centimeter lymph node mobile form palpable in the right axilla. And then I would also like to do the examination of the spine.
And the supraclavicular
fossa.
Okay. Now, it's just the examination limb that you need to describe. Rather than the lesion. And you're right about the left upper limb being normal. Except for the limitation of some movement at the elbow on account of the postmortem contractures. On the right side, you can see is an apparent wasting,
yes,
shriveled limb.
Yes,
and this limb is disused. That's why there is atrophy. You can see the atrophy of all the muscles.
Yes, sir.
You can actually see the bony points clearly,
yes,
all around. Isn't it?
Yes,
sir. Then you can describe the hyperpigmented patches. Hyperpigmented patches and some areas where there is which is probably cystic on account of some kind of a necrosis. So there is an element of necrosis which is extending beyond the lesion you are referring to. The limb is in a position as you rightly described, but there is adduction that she is keeping it in, flexion at the elbow, flexion at the wrist, which is palmar flexion, no?
Yes,
non dorsi. And then here you have classical extension and then flexion, which happened in some kind of what?
Claw hand.
Yes, sir. So the nerve involvement can be ulnar there.
Yes, sir.
That's right. So that you need to look at. Indirectly you can make out. But
yes,
that could also be due to contracture, postbone contracture, so we can't be commenting on it completely. Right, but don't spend a lot of time on this. You have a glaring finding, an ulcer of proliferative growth involving almost the lower one third of the arm and up to the joint. Although the growth you can see is up to the olecranon process.
Yes, sir.
But this is extending beyond.
So the entire area is supposed to be involved. And the fact that you are saying there are axillary lymph nodes, you are looking at
the involvement of the lesion, or this being a lesion which is going deeper and away from the scar tissue.
Yes, sir.
Right, otherwise the diagnosis is glaring.
Yes, sir.
And I am just concentrating on your description mainly first. You are right, over the edges are, especially here, if you can get close and see. It is bleeding on touch.
Yes, sir.
Why does it bleed on touch?
Because of the neovascularization and the vessels are fragile.
The capillaries.
The new capillaries are fragile.
So they give way.
Yes, sir.
And these are the inverted edges here.
You can see them here, right? Margin is irregular. And the surrounding skin, there is no induration. But there is cystic degeneration. So.
Yes, sir.
It will also count as disease.
Yes,
sir. Okay. Clear to you, Hedu?
Yes, sir.
So, the other thing which you need to describe, which you did partly, is the axillary lymph node. And to examine for axillary lymph node is a challenge here, because that's why I wanted to expose this part, to know if there are nodes and plenty of them. One is big, how much is the, describe the
node? So, 2 into 2 centimeter and the other one is 1.5 into 1 centimeter.
I would have preferred to get it completely here, but it's hurting.
Yes, sir.
So, in that case, this position is okay. And in addition to this, supraclavicular lymph node. If you examine it, you can see the scarring is extending. Right over the shoulder, there is contracture here.
Yes, sir. Even for the neck deformity correction.
Yes. No supraclavicular lymphadenopathy. And the pulsations are normally felt.
Yes.
You mentioned about the radius and ulna. Both are felt, but you can't comment on the motor system, I agree with you. Now, if you lift it this way, and bring it here, what would be your diagnosis there?
Sir, a 55 years lady with Marjolin's ulcer.
No, give a better diagnosis.
So, 55 years lady with history of burns. Developing with an ulcerative proliferative growth involving of the right lower third of the right arm, most likely to be malignant in etiology.
What would you like to put it? How old is she?
55 years.
So, 55 years old female, old woman,
lady.
With ulcer proliferative growth on previous bone site, most probably malignant.
Oh, 55 year lady with post bone contractures involving both the upper limbs, but mainly the right upper limb, with an ulcer proliferative growth overlying it, most likely suspected to be Marjolin's ulcer with axillary lymphadenopathy, so clearly indicating it's undergone a malignant change. And the malignant change, what would the lymph nodes indicate here? Because marginal ulcers are not supposed to metastasize to the lymph nodes, because why don't they metastasize?
Because of the damage local
the scarring as damage lymphatic. So if they are involved, that if the lymph nodes are involved, what does it mean?
It has gone deeper and also.
So it's gone into the normal tissue. It's gone into the
normal tissue.
Or they could be due to secondary infection, because you already have
first discharge
and scar. So we have to keep both the options, but the presence of nodes and the nodes with significance slightly on the harder side, you suspect them to be due to
malignancy.
And marginal ulcers can metastasize to the lymph nodes if goes through the
normal
scar tissue to the normal tissue. Okay.
Yes.
And how do you stage it? How do you stage squamous cell carcinomas of the lymphs?
So the TNM staging is Tx when the tumor is not visible accurately, T0 when there is no evidence of tumor, T1 when it is less than 2 cm, T2 when it is 2 cm, T3 when it is more than 4 cm, and
T4?
T4
A and B, A is into contiguous structures, B makes it non dissectable. So this should have gone into the deeper structures. It's already T4.
Yes,
is T4, yes or no?
It is T4A.
So T4A, N1?
MX.
MX or MZ? That's the case. How do you approach now quickly?
I would like to do investigations to confirm the diagnosis, to support the diagnosis and stage the disease, and to treat the patient. To confirm the diagnosis, I would like to do an edge biopsy from the lesion.
Can you show us where you will take the edge biopsy from?
So from the edge. From the edge, sir.
Okay. Why from the edge?
So because edge is maximum proliferative activity, so.
What precaution would you take in this case? You're already saying there is some bit of
cystic degeneration.
So, in order to exclude that it's not inflammatory.
So I would like to give a course of antibiotic to her so that the edema settles and.
The inflammation is settling. What do you mean edema settles? See, the lymph nodes could be due to. You may not find a diagnosis here. You may find the histology is equivocal. We need to repeat it with antibiotics after that. Try to take care of it. What next?
Sir, I would, since there are nodes present, I would also like to do an ultrasound of the axilla as just an extension of the clinical examination. Then, to stage the disease, I would like to do a contrastman CT scan or preferably an MRI of the right of.
The gauze piece of this finally.
To confirm the diagnosis, you'll take an edge biopsy. What will you do to stage?
So to stage the disease, I would like to do contrast MR CT scan, preferably an MRI in this case.
Why? I'll do an X-ray of the limb.
Yes, sir.
So don't unnecessarily waste resources. X-ray of the upper limb, including the joints above and below.
Yes, sir.
To look for any osteomyelitis.
Yes, sir.
Then later on you can go for MRI to look for the soft tissue.
Yes, sir.
And CT scan or MRI, both are fine. But MRI is going to be more useful in the presence of contractures. So we would know how deep is the lesion. And would you do any metastatic workup?
Yes,
a contrast lens is kind of collapsed. It's not required, but it, this being T4, if you can do it, it's fine. Anyway, we'll do a CT thorax
and
that's more or less the scenario. How do you manage? Now, the limb has many problems and it's not a very functional limb.
Yes, sir.
So, probably we can manage by wide local excision with a clear margin and depth. What is the management?
Sir, the management, sir, I would like to discuss it with the patient, the options and since the limb...
That's right, you'll discuss with the patient regarding whether we can preserve the limb.
Preserve the limb.
How much he is keen on it, and we are all keen on preserving it. Not that we don't want to, but it has to be the feasibility.
Yes, sir.
And what would be the management, suppose we have to manage it with limb preservation?
So then I would like to put her on new adjuvant chemotherapy after discussing in MDT and following
it
which...
It won't help. How does squamous cell carcinoma of the skin respond to new adjuvant chemotherapy? It would not actually.
So wide local excision with a 3-dimensional clearance with 2 cm margin with...
So wide local excision, which would mean about a 2 cm margin all around, deep margin would also be the same, but the barriers can be used. And a good digital X-ray can actually show you the barriers. If she is not bothered about the limb preservation, then it's much easier. But for preservation, we'll have to excise the scar. We do a wide local excision with the clearance of the scar along with the
So, sir,
this
scar, you mentioned previously that we do take scar also.
In this case, because the scar is infiltrated, and that's why MRI will show you how far is the growth going.
Yes,
MRI will show you the plane of the lesion, the depth of the lesion, status of the nerves, status of the arteries. That is what MRI will show you better. Lymph nodes are clinically palpable, so there is no issue. So, we don't need a CT for this. CT is just a good X-ray, you can do that, no harm. But basically MRI to know the status of whether the nerves can be preserved. So if the nerves are not fine and if the limb is not going to be functional limb, then we can discuss with the patient that you don't necessarily have a limb which is going to function. So the decision about whether she can be operated or not, the depth would be known by MRI, extent would be known by MRI.
Whether it is resectable or not will be known by MRI. So don't comment on it unless you've done an MRI. MRI will decide whether the limb is preserving, can be preserved or not. Rohita, can you tell us what would be the features that will make it a non-preservable limb?
So, it is extending to the bones,
sir,
lymphovascular invasion. Bone structures out of bone, the neurovascular bundles, the nerve and the vessels.
See, every time we do the same mistake, those two structures are not bone and this. It's a joint, neurovascular bundle, and the bone. So you should, if any two are involved, you are likely, not likely to get a clearance. That is what they say.
Marginal ulcer, that is involving the...
So it's involving the lower one third of the right arm.
And we were discussing as to whether the management is Marjolin. What's a Marjolin ulcer?
So it's squamous cell carcinoma, and which
it may not be squamous cell carcinoma, it can be benign.
So it's a malignant change of the of a bone.
It's an ulcer. Why do we always give a wrong diagnosis? This was discussed even in SCOPE. It's an ulcer that develops on a long-standing scar. Mostly the post-burn scar. And it may not have the malignant changes to begin with. It can undergo malignant change. Do you understand now? And what will be the feature of malignant change in a marjolins? It's not synonymous with squamous cell carcinoma, so you should not get confused. So what will be the malignant change in the features of malignant change in the...
So there will be points in history and points in examination. The points in history, there will be a rapid increase in the
rapid
size.
Rapid increase. Let's take one at a time and don't run away. Increase size rapidly. Okay, next.
So there will be...
they are all present in this, that's why I'm asking.
Weight loss and other
things. May not be weight loss. What else would happen? Oh, what will happen to an ulcer when it starts?
On examination,
on history. It will start bleeding on touch.
Start bleeding.
What else? On examination.
It will have eroded edges.
So the edges will start getting eroded. Again, you can observe that it bleeds on touch. What else?
Fixity.
It'll start getting fixed. Painless would become painful, which I forgot to mention in the history. Cover it up like any other ulcer. There's no rocket science in it. Repeat it. Repeat
so
the points in history.
So there will be points in history. Now, points in
those?
History, there will be a rapid increase in the size. Huh? The painless swelling, it will be painful. And
okay, marjolin. What's a marjolin ulcer?
So it's squamous cell carcinoma, which
it may not be squamous cell carcinoma, it can be benign.
So it's a malignant change of the of a bone.
It's an ulcer. This was discussed even in SCOPE. It's an ulcer that develops on a long standing scar. Mostly the post-burn scar. And it may not have the malignant changes to begin with. It can undergo malignant change. Do you understand now? And what will be the feature of malignant change in a marjolins? It's not synonymous with squamous cell carcinoma, so you should not get confused. So what will be the malignant change in the features of malignant change in the...
So there will be points in history and points in examination. The points in history, there will be a rapid increase in the
rapid
size.
Rapid increase. Let's take one at a time and don't run away. Increase size rapidly. Okay, next.
So there will be...
they are all present in this, that's why I'm asking.
Weight loss and other
things. May not be weight loss. What else would happen? Oh, what will happen to an ulcer when it starts...
On examination,
on history. It will start bleeding on touch.
Start bleeding.
What else? On examination.
It will have eroded edges.
So the edges will start getting eroded. Again, you can observe that it bleeds on touch. What else?
Fixity.
It'll start getting fixed. Painless would become painful. Which I forgot to mention in the history. Cover it up like any other ulcer. There's no rocket science in it. Repeat it.
Repeat the points in history.
So there will be points in history. Now, points in history, there will be a rapid increase in the size. Huh? The painless swelling. It will be painful, and rapid increase in the size. Painless swelling becoming pain.
Painless ulcer now getting infiltration
into the nerves, and it will become painful. Then there will be bleeding, history of bleeding on touch. And points on examination, the ulcer will have irregular margins with eroded edges, and it will be fixed.
And
there will be bleeding on touch.
And what else? Which is present here?
Axillary.
Regional lymph node involvement. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So these features are all present in this?
Yes, sir.
So that would make it a
malignant
change in a Marjolin subset. So don't call it Marjolin, it's not always with all these features. And we already discussed that Marjolin would be, since the scar would have destroyed all the lymphatics. Right?
Yes, sir.
So, and do read about the TNM for skin cancers. It is T4 because it is getting into the contiguous structures, but still resectable, hopefully. Now the question is, you must investigate and repeat the investigation as we discussed.
So to confirm the diagnosis, to support the diagnosis and stage the disease and to treat the patient.
Excellent. So what do you do to confirm?
An edge biopsy.
And how do you avoid the equivocal?
By giving a course of antibiotics.
Antibiotics. Okay. Next.
Then I would also like to do an ultrasound of the axilla, and to stage the disease, I would like to do first the X-ray of the joint and involving
X-ray of the limb. What are the rule of two in a limb?
Two views, two sides, and two joints.
So you would not call X-ray of the joint then. I'll do X-ray of the right upper limb, where we'll look for the joints also, okay? And a good digital X-ray can show you this. What next? How do you know the plane of the swelling?
By doing an MRI of the...
You have an option, MRI versus CT, controversy can go. And it is right when you mentioned that CT is done, but soft tissue sarcomas, extremities, people like to do CTs because they want to see the bone involved. Why do you want an X-ray?
So to rule out osteomyelitis
and
also the plane, the bone involvement if it is there.
That's osteomyelitis and the bone involvement. That you can see on X-ray only. And then you do an MRI or CT to see the depth of it and the status of the nerves, the arteries and the veins. And also this would cover up for the lymph nodes. So you don't need to especially go for an ultrasound separately. You are going to get a assessment of the lymph nodes done anyway. Now that is the stage, the management. Yes, based on imaging, what would you like to discuss with the patients?
So whether the limb is salvageable or not, and whether she would prefer, if it is...
It may not be a functional limb. So we need to explain to the patient that it may not be useful and there is a risk of metastasis. The metastatic workup is CT thorax, just because the axillary lymph nodes are also involved here, it might have gone up. We examined the supraclavicular fossa also. So by and large, it is a disease which has gone to the lymph nodes, which indicates that we are deeper than the scar tissue. Now the resection margins, as you said, management is wide local excision with three-dimensional margin of 1.5 to 2 centimeters. Difficult to assess in the presence of a scar tissue. Once you have done that, your answer would be wide local excision. Suppose you are preserving the limb with a three-dimensional margin with reconstruction. With axillary lymph node dissection, definitely.
Yes, sir.
Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
And since you have given the antibiotics, the inflammatory nodes would have in any case suppressed. There is a case also for doing, when you are doing the ultrasound of the axilla, you would like
FNAC.
To do an FNAC from their lymph nodes, although it would not change your management. So wide local excision, which is three-dimensional margin, with reconstruction, if you are preserving the limb, it has to be a flap. Which flap can reach here?
PMMC.
PMMC is...
So forearm, the other side?
No. forearm, the limb is hardly there.
So they will put the abdominal flap.
You can put an abdominal flap or you can put a free flap. Which can be fibular. But we don't need bone here. If you don't need bone here, then anterior lateral nerve of the thigh, which they take out more commonly than any other place. Or otherwise there is a possibility, this is the limb, as Hetu was saying, you can have a local flap where they take up a radial flap based on this and they put it here. And they adduct the arm and the flap goes there and that can be covered with a graft. The option of PMMC is also there. PMMC can be easily rotated here and will provide the muscle bulk also. So there is an advantage of PMMC in that sense. PMMC would be rotated from here only, no?
Yes, sir.
This is PMMC which will come from here based on peclis major myocutaneous pedicle, which is based on which artery is PMMC based on?
Pectoral branch of thoracoacromial artery.
Which is here, and this is the skin, and this entire thing is shifted here, rotated, and you can actually lie in axis also. And you can have a muscle cover. Basically, you need a myocutaneous flap. But whether the limb is salvageable or not is the issue. If the limb is not salvageable, so the option is an axial flap. Axial means artery. The supply is known. The axis is known. Random is the other name, which is random. Not a rocket science. Why should one forget it? So it is a axial flap based on pectoral branch of thoracoacromial artery, followed by adjuvant radiations if you have preserved it, if the limb is preserved. That's a treatment which is complete, it will be discussed in the MDT. And if the limb is not salvageable, we will have to disarticulate. We cannot do amputation because it won't be functional. Axilla is also involved. So again, MRI/CT. And in MDT, you will take a decision on whether the limb is preservable or not. And usually, this is a neurovascular bundle. That's a bone. That's a nerve, neurovascular bundle. That's the bone. That's the bone. And yellow. The joint, these are the three, one, two, three. Any two of the three, if involved, limb, not preservable. Can you repeat it?
Sir, if any of the two structures that is
any
bone,
any of the three, any two of the three.
Any two of the three, that is the bone, the neurovascular bundle and the joint, if they are involved, then the limb cannot be preserved.
Is that clear now?
Yes, sir.
That applies to soft tissue sarcoma, that applies to any other lesion, so that we can get a clear, we can do a limb preservation. Otherwise, this is not looking like a salvageable limb. Because why is it not salvageable? I'm asking you a question. Yes, why do you think this limb is not going to be very good, very functional?
So because of the history of previous contractures?
No, looking at it now, that history is over.
So it's involving probably the joint, and also it is fixed to the bone, and there is deformity which appears to be due to the ulnar nerve involvement. So on that
and
account...
also, don't you see the muscles are completely
wasted.
Atrophied, wasted. So it won't be a functional limb.
Yes, sir.
Because you can see a disuse of a long time. How old is the history?
20 years of bones.
So 20 years. So this limb is not likely to be functional. And we are taking a huge risk if we preserve it in terms of local recurrence and a distant failure. Therefore, the decision needs to be made with all these factors into consideration. Any questions? A classical case of Marjolin ulcer, and do not ever confuse Marjolin with just squamous cell carcinoma. It may not be. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
The ulcer may be just about a normal ulcer. It starts having ulceroproliferative change.
Essentially, Marjolin says?
Any ulcer developing on a previous scar.
Ulcer on a previous chronic scar. Usually post-birth. Important. And therefore comes the question of whether you remove the scar or not. Scar is removed if the lymph nodes are present. Because then you suspect you have gone through the scar. Okay, and the scar destroys the lymphatics are destroyed. And because they are destroyed, there is usually no regional lymphadenopathy. But if it is present, suspect that all barriers are gone. Therefore, in these cases, you'll have to remove the scar. And whenever you remove it, the defect is huge. No skin grafting. Why skin grafting is not recommended?
So it won't, because of the radiotherapy that will give in the adjuvant period.
And the adjuvant period radiotherapy, it will not be good. And secondly, you can't cover tendons and bone. It's too weak for that. So skin graft is not an option. You have to look for a flap, and preferably an axial or a free flap, where you can cover what you've taken away. So axial we've discussed is one possibility, PMMC, which is good, easy to take and shift. So we can do that. And a free flap would be, obviously you can take any free flap. Free flaps options are just too many. And all of them would require adjuvant
radiotherapy. So in this patient, the scar is not limited, and we cannot
extending towards the shoulder. Yeah, that's a good point. We cannot excise all the scar, because that would mean excising the complete patient. The scar is present up to the neck. But we excise, say this is the lesion. Can you see it?
Yes, sir.
And the scar is extending like this. MRI will tell us how much is the involved scar, and we'll take the involved scar as the disease and take a margin. Is that clear?
Yes. Sir.
That doesn't mean you start counting the neck scar, the contralateral scar, that is not going to be done. Idea is to get the disease out with a clear margin. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Any other question? The metastatic workup is also a question. And TNM is more or less similar, but for skin lesions, there's a slight change. Oral cavity, they were taking the depth of invasion, etc. But the DOI is a factor in oral cavity, but not here. Or even here it's a factor, but you need to, how do you calculate it is an issue. Is that okay? Now this is the case, and based on this you can, any other question with them closing? No? Sukriti, any question?